Here are the ways to stay connected on what God is doing at Calvary. Now, would you please stand as we enter into our call to worship, and thank you for worshiping with us today.
Good morning, and thank you for being at Calvary today. I'm going to read from the 98th Psalm, starting in verse 4. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Break forth into joyous song and sing praises. Sing praises to the Lord with the lyre and the sound of melody, with trumpets and the sound of the horn. Make a joyful noise before the King, the Lord. Let the sea roar, and all that fills it, the world and those who dwell in it. Let the rivers clap their hands. Let the hills sing for joy before the Lord, for he comes to judge the earth. The King is coming. Let's sing praises to the King.
Put your hands together, church. Come on. Let's sing it out to him.
Declare
Good morning and welcome to Calvary. Take a moment and greet one another around you. Good morning. Returning, we watch and we pray. Amen? Amen. Hey, it's great to see you folks with us this morning. My name is Matt Selvig. Here are a couple of announcements for you this morning. First of all, congratulations to the Wensink family. Here's little Adriana. Yes, she was born this last week. Adriana Elizabeth. Yeah, we can give them a round of applause. Absolutely. I'm not sure if Chris and Cara are here this morning or not, but there is going to be a baby basket, which is going to be located in the foyer area. So let's gift them and shower them with a lot of gifts here as they have welcomed their new little one into this world. So baby basket's going to be out there. We're talking, you know, diapers, wipes, anything that you feel is appropriate. Let's do that. Again, the basket is out there as we speak. So let's do that coming up real soon. Awana Clubs. Hey, this Wednesday night is a big night because we've got Awana Clubs. That is going to be starting this Wednesday, okay, 6:25 to 8. So you can check out and make sure you contact the Calvary offices if you have any questions on that. Also, Nexus is beginning. Now, there's a little bit of a difference in Nexus. Check this out. So Radiate, which is the senior high, thank you. The senior high youth group, they're going to be meeting on September 20th at 6:30. Now, that is next Sunday night, so that's a little bit of a change. So senior high is going to be meeting on Sunday nights at 6:30. Meanwhile, the junior high / middle school, you guys are going to be meeting on Wednesday night, okay? So Wednesday night from 6:30 to 8 for junior high, Sunday night 6:30 to 8 for senior high. Also starting on Wednesday night is our core class. So if you're interested in finding out more about what Calvary is all about, what we have our core values are, make sure you come and attend that. That's going to be again on Wednesday night as well, starting this week at 6:30. Those are the offerings for this morning. We have a few more, but we're going to dive into our tithes and offerings this morning. So as the ushers come forward, let's ask the Lord this morning to bless our tithes and offerings. Let's go to prayer together. Father, thank you so much again for your presence in this house today, for your Holy Spirit moving. And as we sing more about the King returning and you, Jesus, coming to return and get your people, Lord, may our hearts be focused on you. We thank you for some of the ministries that we just mentioned a moment ago. We thank you for Awana. Father, in Jesus' name, may you work in the lives of the kids that are going to be attending Awana this year. Lord, use the leaders that you have brought forward to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ and help the children to have fun at Awana, but yet at the same time know that having that personal relationship with you, Jesus, is very, very important. And may kids come to you and give their lives to you. We pray for the senior high and junior high youth groups as well. Oh, Father, as we go through those times in our lives, there's so much pressure to do maybe things that are of the world. I pray against that in the name of Jesus right now. I pray for Pastor Drew that you would equip him with the words and the abilities and the things that he needs to lead the youth group, the youth junior high and the senior high, and lead them well. And for our core class as well, as folks will be coming to find out more about Calvary. You've blessed us, Father, and we give you the praise and the glory this morning. Bless our tithes and offerings this morning. Thank you for the chance for us to be able to give back to you. May it be used for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. As the offering is being taken this morning, we do have a couple of other announcements. Oh, I am stoked for this concert. Yes.
All right, even if you're not totally into music and it's not the biggest thing in your life, you're still not going to want to miss this because this is going to be a great concert. Matt Maher is going to be coming to Calvary, and the tickets are on sale as we speak. Also, the concert is going to be November 19th, Thursday night, so make sure you get that date on your calendar. Do not miss this concert. It's going to be great. The Saints and Sinners Tour, so plan on that. Final announcement for this morning. The Women of Faith 2015 is going to be taking place right here. It's a live simulcast, which is going to be happening here at Calvary on the 2nd and 3rd of October. It's the farewell tour. Now, here's the deal. Tickets are $20. If you are a member, ladies, of Calvary, you'll purchase your ticket for $20. But then the cool thing about it is you get a free ticket to give to a friend, so you can bring a friend. So again, the live simulcast is going to be right here at Calvary, October 2nd and 3rd. If you have any questions, you can talk to Aaron, or I think Bonnie might know some things about that as well. So if you want to find out more about the Live Women of Faith simulcast, that'll be taking place right here, October 2nd and 3rd. Those are the announcements for this morning. Would you please stand again, please, and worship with us through music today. Assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song. The day long. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Perfect submission. Perfect submission. All is at rest. I am my Savior. Am happy and blessed. We're watching and waiting. Looking above, with His goodness, lost in His love. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior. Coming soon, He will.
sing it together.
This is my story.
Yes.
This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long.
Lord, we praise you. We lift your name. Blow the clouds away. Return the triumphant King.
You, oh God, are keeper of your promises. You will return someday.
You, my King.
You, my King, are waiting for the moment to come. And take your bride away.
No one knows.
No one knows the day or time of your arrival. Lord, we pray that this you find.
Oh, listen, church.
Find us loving the unlovable, praying for the lost and lonely. Caring for the broken and bruised. Find us living for your glory. Taking to the streets your story. Sharing with the world your hope and grace. But above all, find us waiting. Still waiting for those to see. You, my love, though we long to be together, so come and take your bride away.
No one knows.
No one knows the day or time of your arrival. Lord, we pray that this you find. For the broken and bruised.
Yes.
Find us living for your glory. Taking to the streets your story. Sharing with the world your hope and grace. But above all this, Lord, find us waiting.
Soon and very soon,
you will open up the skies of heaven and enter it, the King of all kings.
Isn't that right? Come on.
Until that day so glorious, find us not asleep but gone away, Lord, but watching, ready and waiting.
Soon and very soon,
soon and very soon. The skies of heaven and enter it, the King of all kings. Until the day so glorious, find us not asleep but gone away, Lord, watching, ready and waiting. Find us loving the unlovable, praying for the lost and lonely, caring for the broken. Oh, your glory. Take it to the streets, your story. Share it with the world, your hope and grace. But above all this,
but above all, sing it out, find us,
waiting for you, waiting for you, find us, waiting for you, waiting for you, find us, waiting for you, waiting for you, find us, waiting for you, waiting for you, find us, waiting for you, waiting for you, find us, waiting for you, waiting for you, find us, waiting for you, find us, waiting, yeah. Find us waiting for you, waiting for you. Find us waiting for you, waiting for you. Find us waiting for you, waiting for you. Faithfully, faithfully.
Let's pray. Father, we have a blessed assurance. And what we have through your love and through the shed blood of your Son, we long for the day that you come. In finding, may you find us loving the unlovable. Reaching the lost, doing the things we've just sung about. Father, find us waiting. In the close of Revelation, it says, even so, come, Lord Jesus. And we look for that day, that coming, where we will be caught up. And I pray, Father, that you would help us to be faithful to the calling that you have called us to, living in that blessed assurance and looking for the blessed hope and the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. May that be part of our lives. May that be the anticipation that we have. Find us waiting. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Our corporate time of prayer and praise right now, but a prayer reflection, reflecting upon the things that we have just heard and sung. I trust that God has already spoken to your heart, has already challenged you to do the things that were mentioned in that song. We have two requests that we want to mention, and then we're going to ask you as the body of Christ, as a church family, to get together in small little groups and pray together, and praising God for what he's already done in your life. If you have a request, share that with someone that you're praying with, whether it's your family or just a few people around you, but as we spend some time in prayer. But two we want to mention specifically, and that is Mary Scottle has asked us to pray for strength for two of her friends, Renee Talford of Mondovi and a Danette Telejohn of New Richmond. Both are friends of Mary and are going through cancer treatments right now. And so pray for them and pray with Mary for them as she lives out her faith in front of them. And then another one is a praise item, and that is from Kayleen Soden. As you know, she was down with her family, her father, as she was dealing with her family, and then her dad passed away. And she says this, I'm very overwhelmed and comforted in this great time of need. Thank you, Calvary, for being steadfast in prayer for me. God did huge things while I was at my grandpa's. My grandpa passed away peacefully Sunday, August 30th. My cousin got saved while I was there. God called me to plant seeds of his love and comfort many family members. My family asked me to facilitate the funeral, and God gave me the words of salvation to share with all those who came to pay their respects to my grandpa. Thank you to the family in Christ. Whenever I become overwhelmed, Whenever I became overwhelmed while I was gone, I thought about how you were praying for me with such love, and it brought me the comfort and strength I needed to go on. That's what this is about. When we are found waiting, what are we doing while we're waiting? And so we rejoice with Kayleen and what God did through that time. So let's go to prayer right now. Father, thank you for this incredible opportunity to pray together as family. Thank you for the opportunity we have to come into your presence, knowing that our strength, everything that we are, everything that we have, comes from you. Thank you, Father, for the incredible promise we have of your coming. And Father, as we live from day to day, we thank you for opportunities that you put in front of us to be, to share your love, to live confidently before others, to live out our faith, to love and to be just a witness of the light. And so we thank you for every opportunity we go through. Father, thank you for every difficulty that we face. It's not often easy to thank you for the struggles and for the difficulty. But God, thank you that we know that we can come to you, that you are our refuge and our strength and our help in time of need. And may we share that by our response to adversity. May we share that with others and let them know that you are God who cares and loves us, and you love them. We just ask that you would continue to direct us and lead us in this time together. We ask this in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
traffic in the streets. All the builder's tools are silent. No more time to harvest wheat. Busy housewives cease their labors. In the courtroom, no debate. Work on earth is all suspended. As the king comes through the gate, oh, the king is coming, the king is coming. I just heard the trumpet sounding, and now his face I see, oh, the king is coming. The king is coming. Praise God, he's coming for me. Please stand and sing if you want. All the railroad cars are empty as they rattle down the tracks. In the newsroom, no one watches as machines type pointless facts. All the planes veer off their courses. No one sits at the controls. For the king of all the ages comes to claim eternal souls. Happy faces line the hallways. Those whose lives have been redeemed, broken homes that he has mended, those from prison he has freed, little children and the aged, hand in hand stand. I can see the marching throng and the flurry of God's trumpet spells the end of sin and wrong. Regal robes are now unfolding. Heaven's grand stands all in place. Heaven's choir is now assembled. Start to sing. Sing praise, oh, the king is coming, the king is coming. I just heard the trumpet sounding, and now his face I see, oh. Praise God, he's coming for
is coming. Hallelujah. Amen. You may be seated. Hallelujah. The King is coming. After church one day, a little girl had come home for lunch and was sitting with her mommy at the table. Said, "Mommy, we talked about Jesus coming back today." And the little girl said, "Mommy, do you believe that Jesus is coming back?" Mommy said, "Yes." Little girl said, "Well, could he come this week?" Mommy said, "Yes." Little girl said, "Today?" "Yes." "Could he come in the next few minutes?" "Yes, dear." "Mommy, would you please comb my hair?" "Are you ready?" Not on the outside. With all the trappings of religious systems, but on the inside, with the transformation of a righteous Savior. Not with all the externals of a religious system, but with the internal transformation of a righteous Savior. Author Doug Mendenhall shares a brief parable with us that he wrote. "Jesus called the other day to say he was passing through and wondered if he could spend a day or two with us. I said, 'Sure, we'd love to see you. When will you hit town?' 'I mean, it's Jesus, you know. It's not every day you get a chance to visit with him. It's not like it's your in-laws and you have to stop and decide whether the advantages outweigh your having to move to the sleeper sofa.' That's when Jesus told me he was actually at a convenience store out by the interstate. I must have gotten that deer in the headlights look because my wife hissed at me and said, 'What is it? What's wrong? Who's that?' So I covered the receiver and told her Jesus was going to be at our house in 8 minutes. And she ran out of the room and started giving guidance to the kids in that effective way that Marine drill instructors do. My mind was already racing with what needed to be done in the next 7 minutes, so Jesus wouldn't think we were loser slobs who weren't ready. I turned off the TV in the den, which was blaring some weird, scary movie I'd been half watching, but I could still hear screams from our bedroom, so I turned off the reality show that was turned on that the kids were watching, because I didn't want to explain to Jesus about John and Kate plus 8. My wife had already thinned out the magazines that had been accumulating on the coffee table, and she put Christianity Today on top for a good impression. You know, that's what matters. 5 minutes to go. I looked out the front window, but the yard actually looked great thanks to my long, hard work, so I let it go. What could I improve on in 4 minutes anyway? I did notice the mail had come, so I ran out to grab it. Mostly it was Netflix envelopes and a bunch of catalogs tied into recent purchases. So I stuffed it all back in the box. Jesus doesn't need to get the wrong idea, after all. There's only 3 minutes left, and he doesn't really have to see how much online shopping we do. I ran back in and picked up a bunch of shoes left by the door and tried to stuff them in the front closet, but it was overflowing with heavy coats and work coats and snow coats and pretty coats and raincoats and extra coats. We live in the South, so I don't know why we bought so many coats. I squeezed the shoes in with 2 minutes to go. I plumped up the sofa pillows. My wife tossed dishes into the sink and quickly tried to wash them and put them away. I scolded the kids, and she shooed the dog out of the house. And with 1 minute left, I realized something important. Getting ready for a visit from Jesus is not an 8-minute job. And then the doorbell rang. Do you know that in 1999, a survey by Barna Group of Christians around the United States showed that only 44% of all the Christians in churches like this actually believed that Jesus would return in the next 40 years. That was 16 years ago. Last year, that percentage had fallen to 41%. Only 41% of the average person who says they're a Christian in America today believes that in the next 40 years, Jesus is coming back. We have a problem that is fulfilling prophecy. Turn to 2 Peter chapter 3, please. Everything we do and everything we teach in this church is based on the Word of God. If you don't like something that you hear, come and talk to me and make sure that I'm telling you exactly what this said, and if you still don't like it, then take it up with the author. This is the authoritative, inerrant, eternal Word of God that speaks nothing but truth. Please stand as we read these truths from 2 Peter chapter 3. This is now the second letter that I am writing to you, beloved. In both of them, I am stirring up your sincere mind by way of reminder that you should remember the predictions of the holy prophets and the commandment of the Lord and Savior through your apostles, knowing this, first of all, that scoffers will come in the last days with scoffing, following their own sinful desires. They will say, "Where is the promise of his coming? For ever since the fathers fell asleep, all things are continuing as they were from the beginning of creation." For they deliberately overlook this fact, that the heavens existed long ago, and the earth was formed out of water and through water by the word of God, and that by means of these, the world that then existed was deluged with water and perished. But by the same word, the heavens and earth that now exist are stored up for fire, being kept until the day of judgment and destruction of the ungodly. But do not overlook this one fact, beloved, that with the Lord one day is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is as one day. The Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some count slowness, but he is patient toward you, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should reach repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief, and then the heavens will pass away with a roar, and the heavenly bodies will be burned up and dissolved, and the earth and the works that are done on it will be exposed. Since all these things are thus to be dissolved, what sort of people ought you to be in lives of holiness and godliness, waiting and hastening the coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be set on fire and dissolved, and the heavenly bodies will melt as they burn. But according to his promise, we are waiting for new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. Please be seated. Now I need to begin this four-part series called The King is Coming by telling you something very important. This is not going to be a deep, extended study of the theology and the doctrine of what we call eschatology. The word eschatology, it means the study of things to come. This is not an in-depth study of all the different views that there are on the rapture of the church, Jesus coming for the church, and what the tribulation means and all the rest. It is not a deep, intense study of all of that. We did that actually a couple of years ago at this church on Thursday nights, and I hosted a Bible study for 1 year every night in the atrium, and we taught the entire biblical plan of prophecy from the beginning to the end in 1 year, and most of them, if not all of them, are all on our Calvary YouTube site. If you want to go back and watch them someday, you can get all of that information that goes in, all that doctrine. There's no way to bring that down into four sermons. This simple series on The King is Coming is going to simply explain four fundamentals of biblical truth concerning the revealed plan of God for the future. Now, in these four fundamentals, you will see me teaching my biases of understanding what I believe God's Word teaches about some of those doctrines. I'm not going to take the time, and I don't want you to be offended if my view differs from your view. We can still sit down and talk about that. And I'm willing to learn from you and all of your background study on all of this, as well as me sharing with you what I think. The purpose of this sermon series is not to discover who's right and wrong. The purpose of this series is to get us looking up, because the King is coming. The King is coming. But you will see me teaching from a perspective, even in the four sermon titles. So let's look at what's coming, and then we'll start with the first one today. Today we're going to talk about the King is coming for His bride. If you caught that in some of the worship songs that we did, right? The King is coming for His bride. Next Sunday we will speak on the King is coming to prepare His kingdom. This will be the study of what goes on during the seven-year tribulation period as the King prepares His kingdom. The third week will be the King is coming to reign on His throne. What happens at the end of the tribulation when the King actually comes and puts His feet on this earth and reigns on this earth for 1,000 years and the earth is at peace. And then the final sermon will be called The King is Coming to Finalize God's Judgment. The King is coming to finalize God's judgment. So that's the next, counting this week, 4 weeks. At Calvary. So we hope you can join us. And if you miss one, they're online, or you can order the DVDs. The order form should already be out there. Okay, let's get started. The King is coming for His bride. It is very important that I take a few moments here before we get into the 3 points. My granddaughter came to me today. She said, Grandpa, I'm looking at the sheet in the worship folder. You have only 3 points. There's no way you can do that. So, I'm going to take my first digression. It's a planned one, believe me, it's planned. If the King is coming for His bride, we must first describe who the bride is. And the Scriptures very clearly point out to us that the bride of Christ is the church of Jesus Christ. We are the bride of Christ. That's laid out for us in the Apostle Paul's teaching in the book of Ephesians when he says, husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church, and wives, submit yourselves to your husbands out of respect and honor for God. And then he says, this relationship in a marriage relationship on the earth is the picture, it is the mysterious picture of the union between Christ and His bride, the church. This is why it is so important for us to understand the sanctity of marriage between one man and one woman, because it is God's depiction of the sanctity of the relationship between Jesus Christ and all those who call themselves followers of Jesus Christ. There is no other relationship that can depict that, and no one who is in Christ can compromise it, because we are the bride of Christ. But I want you to imagine something for a moment. And I couldn't really find any good records online of the historical context of this, but maybe you know, and if you do, just raise your hand so I make sure I talk to you so that you can fill me in on it. Does anybody know when we started the tradition of the bride walking down the aisle while the groom waits for her? And do you understand how backwards that is from Scripture? Now, I'm not trying to start a rebellion here that we're going to all of a sudden change the way we do weddings, although I'd like to. I would love to see at the next wedding that we do here at Calvary, the symbolism of the church waiting for the groom, that the groomsmen and the maid of honor and the bridesmaids and the bride come out from the side and stand here. And the bride, in all of her splendor and her white gown, representing the white robes of the saints who have been washed and redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ, wait for the groom to arrive. And he walks down the center aisle as everybody cheers and the bride gets excited because it's the groom that is coming to redeem the bride. The bride never redeems the groom. The bride, and ladies, you know this is true. You know this is what you really want. You know that in your heart, since you were a little girl, you've wanted a man to ask you to marry him. You know you have. Because God has placed in the hearts of every one of you women the desire to be taken out of the system of your family and to be brought under the loving, nurturing, caretaking of a man who represents Jesus Christ to you. And you can't wait for that to happen. And yet every wedding we do has the man waiting for the woman. It's backwards. It's backwards. And listen, if you still want to do it that way, I'll still do your wedding. And I won't make an issue of it. Okay? But who's going to be the first? I want to know which one of you young women here is going to be the first one to try this. That the groom, can you imagine the crowd in the church that day? What's the bride doing up there? And they're all whispering to each other, and then all of a sudden the groom comes into this trumpet fanfare because at the sound of the trumpet, the groom returns. The king is coming, and the bride is waiting for the king. That's what a wedding is supposed to symbolize, the union of the church with Jesus Christ. So, having said that, let's get into the three principles that as we wait for the groom to arrive, as we wait for the king, what are the three principles that we need to remember that will help us to live the way Peter tells us to in verse 11, to live in lives of holiness and godliness, waiting for and even hastening the coming of the day of the Lord. Number one, we must look forward with certainty and not backwards with cynicism. You saw that in the passage of scripture that we read, where Peter says that in the last days there will be scoffers who will come with scoffing. It's interesting. There have always been scoffers. There have always been scoffers who mock the truth of Jesus Christ privately to themselves. We happen to live in what I believe are the last days because it has now become tolerable for scoffers to do their public scoffing, and we have to accept it. We now live in these last days where scoffers will come with scoffing. They look backwards and they say, sure, you can tell me all about Jesus coming. Who cares? Look, life goes on, same old, nothing changes. How can you tell me that this Jesus is still coming? And I dare say that far too many of us in the Christian church have bought into that philosophy subtly, and yet we still do it. When was the last time you woke up in a morning and said to your spouse, to your children at the breakfast table, or even to yourself, is this the day? Could this be the day that Jesus comes back? The King is coming for his bride. Don't look backwards with cynicism saying, ugh. Don't become one of the scoffers. Because Jesus said he was coming back for us. Jesus told us himself. Told it to his disciples who had no idea what he was talking about when he said this in John chapter 14, let not your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, then believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. And if it were not so, I would have told you. Would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. And for those of you that wonder if there's a separation between the coming of Jesus for his bride to take us out of the world and the coming of Jesus to settle on this earth as the king of this earth, those are two separate events. And the very first reference that Jesus makes to his coming is not a coming of him to earth, but a coming to get us out of the earth. John 14, 1 through 6. And the disciples said, "How do we know how to get there?" And Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me." Oh, Pastor, that sounds like a pretty exclusive message. Yes, it is. And I'm proud of it. It is absolutely exclusive. It is also totally inclusive, for anyone who will believe will be saved. He is not only the way, he is your way, or can be. But not only did Jesus tell us he's coming back, Jesus told us through the Apostle Peter that we shouldn't worry about how much time it would take, because time is measured differently by God. We read in the passage of Scripture, 1,000 days or 1,000 years is like one day to God. See, we have to understand the concept of God to the best that we can in our finite rational thought process that is limited to the time and space continuum, that God isn't. He's outside of it. God's looking down at seconds and minutes and hours and days and weeks and months and years. And God's looking down at that continuum of time. And he's looking down at the confines of space from the outside of it, not at all ruled by it. He has no beginning and no end. Therefore, everything to God is absolutely the current present. So as God looks down on us at this church right now, he's also in his mind looking at Noah and managing the flood. Even though in our time and space continuum, those are progressive and successive events, they are not to God. And so when we try to put God into the confines of, so because time has passed since you said this and it hasn't happened, therefore it's not going to happen, we have put a finite constraint on an infinite God who is outside of time. Peter told us, don't worry about how long it takes. It's going to happen. Jesus also told us in the book of Revelation through the Apostle John that there's going to be a great marriage feast. In chapter 19 of Revelation, John says this, "Then I heard what seemed to be the voice of a great multitude, like the roar of many waters, and like the sound of mighty peals of thunder, crying out, 'Hallelujah, for the Lord our God, the Almighty, reigns. Let us rejoice and exult and give him glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and the bride has made herself ready. It was granted her to clothe herself with fine linen, bright and pure, for the fine linen is the righteous deeds of the saints.' And the angel said to me, 'Write this, blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb.' And he said to me, 'These are the true words of God.'" Now, lest some of you are already having a digression that, okay, my righteous deeds qualify me to put on the white robes. It says that God has provided the saints with the right white robes that are put on by the doing of the deeds after you've already been made a saint. Please read Scripture carefully. Becoming a saint is an act of God by grace through faith in Jesus Christ, who died on the cross for all of our sin. And there is no righteousness we can put on that matters at all to God. There is no good deed that any of us can do that creates a white robe. They are all the product and only available at the eternal store purchased already by the blood of Christ that resides in you. Jesus told us there's going to be a great marriage feast and that we are to get ready. And Jesus also told us through the Apostle Paul in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 that his return would be unexpected and imminent. Imminent meaning it could happen at any moment. He says this, but we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers, about those who are already asleep, those who have already died. We do not want you to grieve as others who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have already fallen asleep. For this we declare to you by a word from the Lord himself, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a cry of command, with the voice of an archangel, and with the sound of the trumpet of God, and the dead will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so we will always be with the Lord. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. Jesus himself told us, "My return will be unexpected and could happen at any moment. And will we be found waiting and watching?" Look forwards with certainty. Don't look backwards with cynicism. Number two, focus upwards on Christ's return and not around for the Antichrist's rise. Now, having said that, yes, we are to be alert to everything that's going on around us. But I think we've made a terrible mistake in the Christian church of becoming so prideful in our understanding of biblical prophecy that we can figure out everything that's going on in the world around us, and we can tell you what that political thing means and what that recent treaty means and what that potential war means, and we can tell you who we think might be positioning themselves in power and authority to fulfill some prophecy, and we're spending all of this time studying all the stuff that is around us. And we're forgetting that the call of Scripture is for our primary focus is to be upwards, looking for Christ's return. Historian Richard Kyle of Tabor College in Hillsboro, Kansas, and he's the author of a book called The Last Days Are Here Again, he said in an interview in Christian History magazine, "Through much of history, people have been looking more for the Antichrist than they have for Christ himself. And that's because it's more interesting to speculate about who he might be." Sometimes, I say this with sensitivity, sometimes I think we're looking for the rise of the Antichrist only so that we can know and get advanced warning on when Jesus might be returning so we can get our lives back in line, but until then, we're going to live the way we want to. If I only knew when Jesus was coming, I'd be able to spend that last 8 minutes getting my house of my life ready. But until then, don't ask me to look up. I'm going to look around and find out all that I can do for myself. Do we really believe that Jesus is returning at any moment? Ta-da! Oh, were you ready? That was a pretty poor trumpet, wasn't it? How about this? I don't think I could blow it. Where's the trumpet player? Is there a trumpet player here? Ryan, get up here. Here, you want to hear what the trumpet call of God is going to sound like? Come on, Ryan. It's tiny mouthpiece. It's like a Bach 12. See if you can do it. Come on. You can do it.
Nope,
not going to happen, huh? It's really tiny. Yeah. Melinda used to be able to do it. I used to be able to do it. Now imagine that. Imagine that about 500 million times louder. Oh, Melinda! Hey! way back in the old building, the tiny little building that was about this size right here, she used to blow this to start worship every Sunday morning to get everybody's attention. Okay, now. Are you ready for that? Really? You're ready right now to walk away from anything and everything that you're connected to in this life? Seriously? Look deep. You're ready to walk away from anything and everything you're connected to in this life? That at the sound of the trumpet call of God and the mighty shout of command from the holy temple of God, Jesus says, come here. He's coming back. Number three, look inward to prepare for eternity rather than outward at the pleasures of the earth. Look inward to be prepared for eternity. Do we have that one? Rather than outward at the pleasures of the earth. I want you to look at a passage of scripture that Jesus and the Holy Spirit gave to the Apostle Paul in 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 9 and 10, where Paul says this, for they themselves report, these are other people that have been observing what the church is about, for they themselves report concerning us the kind of reception we had among you and how you turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus, who delivers us from the wrath to come. Turning from the worship of what this world offers and preparing for eternity. We, the children of God, are the bride of Christ. And the pointed and serious question that has to be answered today is this: are we faithfully preparing for the wedding? Or are we unfaithfully planning for the present pleasures of this life? Are we preparing for the wedding? Or are we participating in the pleasures of this world? What is our focus? So go back to the opening illustration a minute of what a wedding should look like. The bridesmaids have walked out from behind the stage, and the groomsmen have walked out from behind the stage, and they've come together in the middle here and climbed over the drums, and they're standing right here. And then the bride makes her entrance, and she comes out and stands, and she's wearing what used to be a white dress that is now stained and spotted with mud and grime and grease. Her veil is torn. Her jewelry is missing gems. She has one shoe on, one shoe off. And in order for her foot to stay warm, the shoe that is not on, the foot that does not have a shoe, is wearing a purple and yellow sock. Her dress has holes in it. It's much too big for her because she has tried to keep it stuffed with all the stuff of life. And she comes and stands in front of all of you and tries to convince us that she's prepared for a wedding. Now, you know the reality. She got here to the church at 6:30 that morning. Scott had to get the doors open really early so the bride could get in and get pampered and primped and prepped. She's been to the bathroom countless number of times to look in the mirror to check her makeup. She's cried several times with friends as they've talked about stuff, and then she's gone back to put her makeup back on because at any moment the call could come. The wedding is about to start. And you want to be absolutely at your finest when the groom walks down the aisle. The king is coming. Robbie Robbins was an Air Force pilot during the first Iraqi war. After his 300th mission, he was surprised to be given permission to immediately pull his crew together and fly his plane home. They flew across the ocean to Massachusetts and then a long drive to western Pennsylvania. They drove all night. And when his buddies dropped him off at his driveway just after sunup early that morning, there was a big banner across the garage that said, "Welcome home, Dad." How did they know? No one had called. It was not on his agenda, his itinerary. He wasn't scheduled to be home for weeks. The crew themselves had not expected to leave so quickly. And Robin says, "When I walked into the house, the kids, half dressed for school, screamed, 'Daddy!'" And his wife came running down the hall, hair fixed, makeup on, in a brand new crisp yellow dress. And Robbie said, "How did you know?" And through tears of joy, she answered, "I didn't. But once we knew the war was over, we knew you'd be home one of these days. We knew you'd try to surprise us, so we've been ready every day. We've been ready every day." The king is coming for his bride. James Allen, as your team comes, let me share with you the words of a new worship song that's come out from Christian Stanfill. Just one verse and chorus from this song that's called "Even So Come." Call back the sinner, wake up the saint. Let every nation shout of your fame, Jesus is coming soon. Like a bride waiting for her groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing, "Even so come, Lord Jesus, come." Let's pray. Father, we will be a church. Not the physical structure of the church, not the elder board and deacons and leadership team. The church made up of individuals who are born again by the blood of Jesus Christ, with anxious anticipation of the return of the King. We will be the body of Christ, the church that is constantly looking for the return of the King. And while we wait, we will call forth the sinners who can be forgiven. We will extend to them the grace and the mercy of Jesus Christ that will love them as they are and forgive them for their sins so they can experience the transforming Redeemer in their heart. We will serve you faithfully every day, pursuing eternal values and not earthly ones. For very soon, the clouds will roll away. The trumpet will sound. And Jesus will say, "Come to the wedding." Oh, what a glorious day that will be. Oh, what a glorious day. Jesus, come. Come. Please rise.
One day when heaven is filled with His praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came for to be born of a virgin, dwelt upon men, my example was He. The Word became flesh, light shined among us, His glory revealed. Living, He loved me. Dying, He saved me. Buried, He carried my sin far away. Rising, He justified freely forever. One day He's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. One day they lay of Calvary's mountain, one day they nailed Him to die on a tree. Suffering, anguish, despised and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is He. Yeah. The hands that heal nations stretched out on a tree, He took the nails from me. Living, He loved me. Dying, He saved me. Buried, He carried sins far away. Rising, He justified freely forever. One day He's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day.
Praise you, Jesus. Yes.
One day the grave could conceal Him.
Death could not hold Him. The grave could not keep Him. He's rising again. Living, He loved me. Dying, He saved me. Buried, He carried my sins far away. Rising, He justified freely forever. One day He's coming. Oh glorious day, oh glorious day.
sing it out together, church.
Thank you, Jesus.
Living, He loved me.
Trumpet will sound. Jesus, let it be today. But you're being patient because, as Peter told us, you do not want anyone to perish. And if you're here today and you do not have that incredible hope, that certainty, and you're looking at life with cynicism because you have not repented of your sin and received the redemption, the forgiveness, the unconditional love of Jesus Christ. You're not ready. Lord, be patient long enough for those to come. But do not delay your coming for them who refuse. Today is the day of salvation, Paul says. Now is the accepted time, because the trumpet could sound at any moment. Are you ready? If you are, would you please go and live like it? Serving Jesus with the enthusiasm that He's coming. And I can't help but want to sing that last verse again. One day the trumpet will sound, and close with that chorus one more time. If you have to leave, don't delay. But if you want to just celebrate that one more time with me, let's do it, okay? One day the trumpet.
One day the trumpet will sound for His coming. One day the skies with His glory will shine. Wonderful day, my beloved, will bring it. My Savior Jesus is mine. Sins far away, rising He justified, freely forever, one day He's coming, what a glorious day.
Give a shout, church, we praise You, Father, one day, glorious day.
Amen, amen. You guys are dismissed. Have a good one.
Forever, one day He's coming. Oh, this day.